The introduction of a research paper. In a research paper, the introduction section comes immediately after the abstract and keywords. The introduction is of prime importance in grabbing the attention of the readers, especially the reviewer. It must make them hooked to encourage them to read more. This section makes up about 10% of the entire article, or about 400 words, spread over 3 or 4 paragraphs, on a 4,000-word paper. It is preferable to write it in an inverted pyramid manner, meaning we go from the general to the specific, so we pave 2 lines about the general field of the article and then reach the point of the article. What is the purpose of the introduction section? Presenting the research problem and how you arrived at it simply, the introduction should answer the question, why? Why did you choose this topic for research? Why do you see it important? You can also think of the introduction as a section that indicates the knowledge gap that you will fill in the rest of the paper. You explain why you undertook your study, what you aim to achieve with it, and how this constitutes a useful addition to the existing body of evidence on this topic. That means you should start by explaining briefly, using appropriate references, what is already known about this subject. You should then narrow the field down somewhat and identify the areas where there is still some uncertainty, citing where appropriate, any previous and possibly conflicting data. This will logically lead to a description of an explicit gap in the knowledge that your study hopes to fill. This is an essential element in justifying the utility of your work. Having now explained how your study is going to contribute something new and useful, you should clearly state your working hypothesis, followed by your objectives, and very briefly, the strategy implemented to achieve these goals. The other job the introduction has to do is provide some background information and set the context. You can do this by describing the research problem or the research question. Remember that a master's thesis and a doctoral dissertation usually have a separate chapter about the literature review, but a research paper does not have such a section. Instead, the introduction includes a brief review of the literature outlining where your predecessors have come. In the background, the reasons that prompted you to undertake your research should be clear and justified by the state of scientific knowledge with appropriate references. It is not necessary to cite every article in the literature on the topic. A careful selection of the most pertinent publications is sufficient. Similarly, it is not necessary to state universal truths that may seem oversimplistic or eminently obvious. Yet you should try to achieve a suitable balance between relevant background information and excessive detail. In this regard, you should keep in mind the target audience you are aiming for. The introduction should logically flow towards the identification of the gap in knowledge that you hope to fill. This is your opportunity to state the added value of your study, or the new information that your study will yield. Will your results change clinical practice? Will they help the scientific community at large to move towards consensus on a previously controversial topic by providing hard evidence in one direction or the other? This is your chance to make a sales pitch for your article, in the appropriate terms. Now that you have given the background and set the context, the final part of the introduction should define the objectives of the experiment or analysis of the study described in the paper. This concluding part of the introduction should include specific details or the exact question or questions that must be answered later in the paper. The formulation of your objective is of paramount importance, and you should take the time to think about this carefully. The objective must be explicitly stated, and should include the exact parameter you aim to assess, and by what means. To write the introduction section, we have 4 steps. 1. Provide background information and set context. This initial part of the introduction prepares readers for more detailed and specific information to be provided at a later time. The first 2 sentences are usually broad. Here are some examples. Thus, a paper on soil organic matter could begin. Sustainable crop production is related to the physical and biological properties of soil, which in turn are significantly affected by soil organic matter. A paper discussing the potential beneficial role of bacteria in cancer treatment could begin as follows. The role of bacteria as an anti-cancer agent has been recognized for nearly 100 years. At the same time, the introductory statement should not be too broad. Note that in the above examples, the introduction does not start by talking about agriculture or cancer, but by referring to organic matter in the soil and the role of bacteria. Once you have entered the first sentence of the wide field, the next sentence can refer to the specific region within that wide field. 2. Introduce the specific topic of your research and explain why it is important. As you can see from the above examples, authors tend to present their research topic. Now in the next part, you can bring in some insights to show the importance of the topic or the severity of the problem. Here are some examples. A paper on fighting malaria by taking preventive measures could indicate the number of people affected, the number of hours a person has lost, or the cost of treating the disease. Example. A paper on the development of crops that require little water can refer to frequent severe droughts or reduced crop yields due to drought. Another way to emphasize the importance of the research topic is to highlight the potential benefits from solving the problem or from finding an answer to the question, possible savings, increased production, longer equipment life, etc. This approach confirms the positive. For example, instead of saying that $80 million are lost to malaria each year, say $80 million per year could be saved if malaria were prevented. 3. List the previous attempts to solve the research problem or answer the research question. As mentioned before, a formal literature review is not featured in the introduction section of a research paper. However, it is appropriate to point out any relevant previous research and explain how your research differs from those attempts. The differences can be simple. They may have repeated the same set of experiments but with a different organism, or they may be elaborate, involving more sophisticated analytical tools, or advanced study with a larger and more diverse sample, or a vastly different geographic setting. Here are two examples. Although these studies were valuable, they were conducted when the genome sequencing project was not available, and therefore provide little information about evolutionary and regulatory mechanisms. The response of plants changes due to insect colonization and behavior, but these aspects are mostly studied in single crops, while this paper investigates the relationship between crops and pests in the intersphere. 4. Conclude the introduction by stating the specific objectives of your research. The preceding paragraphs should logically lead to specific and clear objectives of your study. Note that this part of the introduction gives specific details. For example, the previous part of the introduction might mention the importance of malaria control, while the concluding part outlines the control methods used and how they are evaluated. At the same time, avoid too much detail because those belong in the materials and methods section of the paper. If, for example, your search is about finding the correct proportions of two metals in an alloy and you test 10 different dimensions, you don't have to list all 10. Suffice to say that the proportions vary from 50, 50 to 10, 90. There are different ways to build goals. The use of questions, hypotheses, and concepts are the most common combinations. Introduction items may differ from one journal to another, therefore, you must be sure of what the journal in which you want to publish accepts, by looking at the last thing it published, and sticking to the same elements without any addition or subtraction. Some scientific fields follow the premises of their research in the form of funnel shape, and proceed from the general to the particular. Here you start by presenting the importance of the topic in general, then you provide a summary of the information related to the aspect you are researching, then you specify the question that you are addressing with your research, and finally, you indicate how you were able to answer the question. Don't forget to check the instructions for authors of your target journal carefully, for any indications regarding the appropriate length for the introduction. In the absence of any explicit recommendations, it is considered that the introduction should be around 1 to 1.5 pages. Using tenses in introduction and literature review, we use a mixture of several tenses: present tense, present perfect tense, past tense, present tense. When talking about general facts, example, smoking increases the risk of coronary heart disease. Present perfect, it is used to describe events that have occurred in the past but are still ongoing. Example 1. Researchers have investigated many areas, such as the focus of teachers' comments and the nature of comments. Example 2. Market risk has been ranked as the most important risk for all types of farm enterprise. Past tense. It is used when looking at past studies or past and over events. Example. Two studies showed that the free surface can have a significant effect on the dynamic response of the plate.